So welcome to the Good Ancestor, How to Think Long-Term in a Short-Term World. My name is Jano Mendler de Suarez, and I'll be facilitating this event along with Pablo Suarez. We're both affiliated with the Boston University Pardee School of Global Studies, Frederick S. Pardee Center for the Study of the Longer Range Future, and the Red Cross Red Crescent Climate Center. And we're very grateful today to Climate-KIC for supporting this event through their deep demonstration long-termism initiative. This is a rather unconventional event because it features cartoon artists with a public philosopher, who I'm looking forward to introducing to you shortly. He's going to be speaking for about 25 minutes. And this event also features you as active participants. But before we begin, you're going to need to choose one of the themes that we'll be discussing in just a few moments. There are questions which have been suggested by our speaker that you can see on the screen to help you make a selection so that you can be put into a breakout group following the talk. It is now my immense pleasure to introduce to you Roman Krznaric. He's a public philosopher who writes about the power of ideas to change society. His books, including Empathy, The Wonder Box, and Carpe Diem Regained, have been published in more than 20 languages. His new book, The Good Ancestor, How to Think Long-Term in a Short-Term World, has been described by U2's The Edge as the book our children's children will thank us for reading. After growing up in Sydney and Hong Kong, Roman studied at the universities of Oxford, London, and Essex, where he gained his PhD in political sociology. He went on to found the world's first empathy museum. He's previously been a consultant to organizations including Oxfam, Friends of the Earth, UNDP, and he's currently a research fellow of the Long Now Foundation in San Francisco. His book, The Good Ancestor, How to Think Long-Term in a Short-Term World, was released yesterday, and he's going to launch it now with us. Over to you, Roman.
Thanks so much for that lovely introduction, Jeannot, and it's a great pleasure to be here and to see you all and to launch The Good Ancestor in the United States. And for me, this is a really exciting event because for the last few weeks, I've been working with three incredibly creative and inspiring cartoon artists. I've been sharing my book with them and we've been going back and forth with ideas of how to bring it to life visually. And that's what we'll be doing after the talk. So that's going to be really, really interesting, I think. But let me just start by saying that, of course, I'm going to be talking about some themes from this book, particularly the four that you've just been looking at and selected your group for, which is part of the book, but not the whole of the book, but what I think are key aspects of how we can become good ancestors, the big question of our age. And I think we intuitively understand the key question here, which is to recognize the chronic short-termism of the world that we live in. We know our politicians can't see beyond the next election or even the latest tweet. Markets spike, then crash in speculative bubbles. Businesses can't see beyond the quarterly report. Our nations sit around international conference tables, bickering away while the planet burns and species disappear. And of course, as individuals, we are responding to our instant text messages, buying fast food, clicking that buy now button. And this is the age of the tyranny of the now. And we know it matters. We know we need more long-term thinking. We need it in public health care. Those countries that had long-term pandemic plans in place, like Taiwan, have dealt with coronavirus much more effectively than those which didn't. The United States, of course, having effectively abolished its pandemic response unit in the National Security Council in 2018. We know we need long-term thinking to deal with racial injustice, which is embedded generation after generation in criminal justice systems, in cultural life and other public institutions. We needed to deal with the technological risks which are on the horizon, from AI, lethal autonomous weapons, to genetically engineered pandemics. And of course, we need long-term thinking to deal with the climate crisis and the broad ecological crisis, climate change, ocean acidification, biodiversity loss. And we know that the impacts of that crisis are rushing towards us at speed. They're already hitting people in low-income countries, particularly droughts, floods, extreme weather events. So in a way, we've got a paradox here, that the need for long-term thinking is incredibly urgent. This is a crisis of this moment. And the way I think about it is that I believe that humankind has colonized the future. We tend to see the future, particularly in high-income countries, as a distant colonial outpost where we can freely dump ecological degradation, technological risk, nuclear waste, as if there was nobody there. And it's a bit like the way when Britain colonized Australia in the 18th, 19th century, they drew on a legal doctrine known as terra nullius, nobody's land. So they treated Australia as if there were no indigenous people there. Of course there were. And I think today we're in an age of tempus nullius. We see the future as nobody's time, an uninhabited territory that's ours for the taking. And the tragedy of this situation is that future generations aren't really here to do anything about it. They can't block an Alabama bridge like a civil rights protester. They can't throw themselves under the king's horse like a suffragette, or go on a salt march to defy their colonial oppressors like Mahatma Gandhi. They're given no power at the ballot box or in the marketplace. And someone who really recognized this issue, actually back in the 1970s, was Jonas Salk, the great immunologist who, together with his team, developed the first polio vaccine in 1955. But you know, about 20 years later, he said that the great question facing our civilization is this: are we being good ancestors? In other words, how are we going to be remembered by the generations to come? And that question certainly resonates with me today and probably with you today. That's why you're here. And Salk recognized that if we were going to deal with the great challenges of our time, the destruction of the natural world, the nuclear threat, for example, we needed to extend our time horizons. So instead of thinking on a scale of seconds and minutes and hours, we needed to think on a scale of decades and centuries and even millennia. And that, I believe, is the great challenge of our time. And there's some really inspiring examples of this kind of long-term thinking going on even today. So for example, there's this Svalbard seed vault that you may have heard of in the Arctic Circle, part funded by the Norwegian government, which is maintaining the world's plant biodiversity. It's got over a million seeds from 6,000 species have been put into an indestructible rock bunker designed to last for 1,000 years. Or there's the 10,000 year clock, which is being built by the Long Now Foundation, where I'm a research fellow. At this moment, as we speak, this clock is being built inside a limestone mountain in the Texas desert. It's designed to last 10 millennia. Stay accurate for that long. You'll be able to visit it by hiking through the desert. You'll get there and walk up steps cut into the mountainside, each of them the equivalent of a million years of geological time. And then you'll be able to go and see the clock, which is almost like a secular altarpiece for a long-term thinking civilization, to inspire us to take responsibility for the generations to come. Now, as I give you those examples, you've probably been thinking of your own examples. And what I'd love you to do for me now is just there in the chat box, if you can open the chat box, I'd like you just to write down, just in a sentence or two, some inspiring examples of long-term thinking projects that you may have come across. They may be from the scientific realm or the cultural realm. You might be thinking of the Sagrada Familia, the great basilica in Barcelona, you know, which was begun in the 1880s and which is still being built today. I mean, you may be thinking of, you know, pieces of fusion research, you know, in Switzerland or in France. Someone's just mentioned SETI, the search for extraterrestrial life, extraterrestrial intelligence. Oh, someone's put in one of my favorite books there, from Les Kaufman's put in the Foundation trilogy by Isaac Asimov, which I've got right here on my desk, always within arm's reach, which getting us to think on a scale of thousands of years. Someone's mentioned the Future Library, a beautiful 100-year art project from the artist Katie Patterson, and tree planting examples as well in indigenous cultures. I'm going to talk about those. Well, you're all keyed up on long-term thinking. But what I'd love to do now, and I hope we can come back to some of those brilliant examples, there's more coming in there, the Voyager 1 and 2, Onkalo nuclear fuel repository in waste repository in Finland, another great example. But what I'd love to do now is talk about four different ways we can really practice long-term thinking. As I said, this is not an exhaustive survey from my book. In my book, I talk a lot about regenerative economic design and deep time and other aspects, but I want to focus on these four that you know about now of intergenerational justice, cathedral thinking, legacies for the future, and redesigning democracy. And let me begin with thinking about intergenerational justice. I mean, Groucho Marx famously said, "Why should I care about future generations? What have they ever done for me?" And I think that's something a lot of us intuitively feel. You know, how do we even connect with those future generations? Why should they really matter to us? And in fact, if you look at the way government works, future generations don't matter. You may know about the idea of discounting a sort of an economic sleight of hand, or what looks like an irrational economic methodology, which I think is a form of intergenerational injustice and oppression. Governments use discount rates to assess whether they'll invest in long-term projects like a renewable energy scheme or a public hospital. And what they do, in the same way that someone, the more distance they are from you, the smaller they get, that's how discounting works. The further away generations are from today, the less value is given to projects which might potentially benefit them, as those projects don't go ahead. So how should we think about intergenerational justice? What obligations do we have to future generations? Well, let me just share an image for you now, which I think for me certainly encapsulates our relationship with future generations. It's called The Scale of Unborn Generations, developed by a great writer called Richard Fisher. You'll see there in the small green circle, that's the living, the 7.7 billion of us who are alive today. In the gray circle are the 100 billion dead. If we cast our minds back 50,000 years, that's the estimated number of people who've lived and died. And if we cast our minds forward 50,000 years, this is really long-term thinking, I admit, then an estimated 6.7 trillion people will be born, assuming that the 21st century's birth rates level out and remain constant. So there in that giant orange circle are our future generations, our children and their children, your nephews and nieces and their children. And of course, they far outweigh all of us alive today and everyone who has ever lived. And this, in philosophical terms, is a kind of a set of scales, utilitarian thinking, weighing up the responsibility we have to those huge amount of future generations. But there's other philosophical approaches taken by people like John Rawls or Derek Parfit. So for instance, you know, in the same way that we may have an obligation not to plant a bomb in a railway carriage that would blow up some children right now, we've got the same obligation not to plant a bomb that would go off in 10 minutes or 10 hours or even 10 years, that the temporal distance shouldn't make a difference. We should be caring about those future people, no matter where they are, how distant they are from us. And one of the, I think, a cultural practice that really embodies this idea of intergenerational justice is the idea of seventh generation thinking, very common in North America amongst Iroquois people or in Lakota Nation, this idea of making decisions based on the impact seven generations ahead. And that idea of seventh generation thinking, which is a kind of a sort of form of ecological stewardship, has started spreading far and wide. Even the Nobel Prize winning economist Eleanor Ostrom was a great fan of it, saying, you know, "I'm deeply indebted to the indigenous peoples of the US who had an image of seven generations as being the appropriate time to think about the future. And I think we should all reinstate in our minds that seventh generation rule. When we make really the really big decisions, we should ask not only what will it do for me today, but what it'll do for my children and my children's children and their children's children long into the future." And I think it's really extraordinary that this idea is starting to shape political activism as well. So the image there is of a movement, an organization you might know called Our Children's Trust in the US, who are campaigning for legal rights for current and future generations to a clean and healthy atmosphere. And it's an extraordinary idea to give rights to future people. It's based on thinking that, or some very important legal cases come out of the Philippines in the 1990s. In many countries, there are legal campaigns now going on for rights for future generations. The US one is Our Traditions Trust directly draws on that seventh generation principle. They've got a Dave and Goliath kind of battle ahead of them. In fact, they're really struggling, but I think these kinds of struggles will go on as they take legal cases at the state and at the federal level. But let's just stop for a moment and thinking about intergenerational justice. It is a challenging area because, well, why should we care about so much about those future generations compared to people today? Right now, as I speak, 150 million children are facing mortality due to malnutrition. So why shouldn't we be focusing more on them than on future generations? Equally, there's the problem of the legal enforcement of future rights. We can't even enforce rights for people today, Indigenous people or people who are facing police brutality. So it's a bit pie in the sky, you might think, to have campaign for rights for future generations. And that's a question worth contemplating or thinking about for when we go into the discussion afterwards. But now let me just turn to my second approach, which is cathedral thinking. And cathedral thinking is the idea of embarking on projects with time horizons lasting decades or even centuries, just like the medieval cathedral builders would start building their religious edifices, even knowing they may not be completed within their own lifetimes. Greta Thunberg has famously said that we'll need cathedral thinking to deal with the climate crisis. Now, just to show you another image there, cathedral thinking has a long history. Humans have an incredible ability to think and plan for the long term. We're really good at this compared to most animals. In the top left-hand corner, you can see the Great Wall of China. During the Ming Dynasty, they spent 200 years building the Great Wall of China, a long-term project, and it's still there today. On the right-hand side, you can see a great example of long-term cathedral thinking from public health. Those are the sewers built in Victorian Britain in the 1860s and 70s after the famous Great Stink of 1858, when the stench from raw sewage being dumped in the Thames was so great that Parliament finally, in the crisis, passed a bill and to fund the building of sewers. Sir Joseph Bazalgette, the famous engineer, he built these sewers using bricks that would last a century. He built the sewers twice as big as they needed to be. This was about building resilience into the public health system, something we definitely need today, as we know with coronavirus. And in the bottom corner, you can see the suffragettes in the UK who founded their first organization in 1867, didn't achieve their aims for at least 50 years of votes for women. It's a reminder that cathedral thinking is something that also happens amongst social movements, civil rights movements, indigenous rights, rights for disabled people all across the board. Today, I think we can see the importance of cathedral thinking in relation to the great tsunami that hit Japan in 2011. On the right-hand side, you can see there, which is the Fukushima nuclear plant, which of course went into meltdown back in 2011 because of the tsunami. But on the left-hand side is another nuclear plant called the Onagawa plant, which you may not know about. This one was hit by the tsunami even harder, yet it survived. Why? Because the chief engineer behind it decided to put a wall, build a wall that was 15 meters high, twice as high as the bureaucrats said was actually required. And he made sure it was built 15 meters elevated as well. And that's why it survived the tsunami. Why did he do that? Well, he did it. It's extraordinary, actually. He remembered from visiting a shrine in his childhood, the chief engineer, and the shrine had a plaque announcing that in the 9th century, a tsunami had destroyed this shrine that was 7 miles inland in the same kind of area. So he recognized tsunamis could come. This is about resilience, right? We need this resilience built into our systems and economic, political systems, social systems to deal with climate impacts and many other impacts as well. But let's remember that cathedral thinking isn't always good for us. Hitler wanted an 1,000-year Reich. The North Korean dynasty wants to continue generation after generation, passing power and privilege on through the family. And of course, we see this in the corporate world too. A former head of Goldman Sachs, Gus Levy, once said, "We're greedy, but long-term greedy, not short-term greedy." Well, that's a very narrow form of cathedral thinking, not one that I support in my book. And that's partly why I want to tell you about a third form of long-term thinking, which is considering the legacies that we leave that can help expand our sense of what the goal of long-term thinking should really be about. Now, if you think about legacies, we are the inheritors of extraordinary legacies from the past, aren't we? We are the beneficiaries of those who planted the first seeds in Mesopotamia 10,000 years ago, people who built the first cities where we still live, who made the medical discoveries we benefit from. But equally, we are the inheritors of negative legacies of two from our, what I might call our bad ancestors, those who bequeathed us colonial era and slavery era racism, which is still part of our policing systems and judicial systems. Interestingly, Leila Saad, who's written a great book called Me and White Supremacy, talks about being a good ancestor. And this is about trying to challenge intergenerational injustice. It's about thinking what our legacies will be. We can all ask ourselves, well, what kind of legacy do we want to leave for future generations? How do we want to be remembered? And I think you can think about legacy in three different ways. The first is the idea of egotistical legacy. That's the idea of leaving a legacy so when you die, you'll be remembered for your great deeds, like a Russian oligarch who wants a wing of a national gallery or a football stadium named after them. A second form is familial legacy. So that's the very common one where we want to pass on things to our children or grandchildren, like wealth or property or money, or pass on religion or culture or language. But I think if we're going to be good ancestors, we need to think about leaving what I think of as a transcendent sense of legacy, a legacy for the universal strangers of tomorrow, people we will never meet, we will never know. Now, it's quite hard, I admit, to make a connection with them, particularly in our highly individualistic world. But let me take you on a little thought experiment to help you try and imagine those future generations. I call it the great chain of life. It's been inspired by a great long-term thinker called Ella Saltmarsh. What I'd love you to do here, just for a moment, is to shut your eyes and imagine a child who you know and care about. Maybe it's a nephew or niece or godchild or one of your own children or grandchildren. Just picture their face for a moment. And now I want you to imagine that same child 30 years in the future. Again, picture what they look like. What's going on in the world around them? What are their joys? What are their struggles? And now, in a final step, I'd like you to picture them on their 90th birthday party. They're surrounded by family and friends and loved ones and old work colleagues. Picture their face again, 90 years old. Walk over to the window, look outside. What's happening in their world? And now imagine someone comes over to them and gives them a tiny baby, places the baby in their arms. It's their first great-grandchild. And they look down at that baby and they think to themselves, wonder to themselves, what will this child need to survive and thrive into the years and decades ahead? What kind of sustenance and support will it need? Now just open your eyes again and consider that that tiny baby could be alive well into the 22nd century. Their future isn't science fiction, like in an Asimov novel. It's an intimate family fact. They're only a couple of steps away from you. And I certainly, when I do that exercise, which I admit can be quite confronting, I recognize that that child is not all alone. It's part of a web of relationships. It's part of the living world. So if we care about that child's life, we need to care about all life. We need to care about all of those people, like the ones in the big orange circle, the air that they breathe, the food that they eat. It's about a transcendent step from familial to a larger sense of legacy. I think they're wonderful examples of the way individuals, inspiring individuals, have left legacy gifts to the future, a bit like in this kind of way. Think of Wangari Maathai, who won the first woman to win the Nobel Peace Prize, first African woman to win the Nobel Peace Prize. In the 1977, she founded the organization, the Green Belt Movement, to empower women and to regenerate the natural world in Kenya. By the time of her death in 2011, over 25,000 women had been trained in agroforestry skills. Over 40 million trees had been planted. And even today, it goes on. They're working with over 4,000 communities of women across Africa. That's leaving a real legacy gift for the future, and I think it can inspire us all. But let me now turn to my fourth point, which is about politics and redesigning democracy. Now, I used to be a political scientist for my sins, and in the 10 years that I was apparently an expert on democratic governance, it never once occurred to me that we disenfranchise future generations in the same way that women and slaves have been systematically disenfranchised in the past and continue to be so in many ways. You know, but I think that's the reality. Future generations have very little place in our political systems. They have no voice or representation. And many people say, well, if we're going to deal with this and deal with thinking about the long term, forget democracy, actually, because all those squabbling democratic politicians are so caught in short-term cycles. We need benign dictators, people say. We need enlightened despots. We need to be more like China. Think of their amazing long-term investment in renewables. We need to be like Singapore. Think of their incredible investment for the long-term in housing and education. Well, it's a very enticing idea, that benign dictator argument, but I just don't believe it. And the reason I don't believe it is because in my book, I did some research on it to find out, well, what's the evidence about whether democracies or autocracies are better at long-term performance in terms of public policy? And let me just show you an image from my book, which relates to this. I work with a brilliant statistician and scientist called Jamie McQuilkin, who's developed something called the Intergenerational Solidarity Index, which is featured in the book. And what it does is it measures 122 countries on long-term public policy performance in areas including economics, social factors, as well as environment. It's a composite indicator. It puts together 10 different measures from, you know, carbon footprint to long-term investment in primary education. And what you see on the left is a map of where, you know, the darker pink means better at long-term thinking, higher levels of intergenerational solidarity, clustered around Europe, other parts of the world as well. But on the right-hand side, you see the league tables, which I love. The top 24 there, you've got Iceland and Sweden on top, but it's not all OECD countries. There is, you can see, Costa Rica and Uruguay and Sri Lanka and Nepal. So there's quite a mix of countries there. But what we did is we did a scatter plot, and you can see here on this next graph, along the x-axis is intergenerational solidarity. So from 0 to 100, high is more long-term thinking, more intergenerational solidarity. On the y-axis is a measure of democracy, a very famous one called VDEM, liberal democracy, from the University of Gothenburg in Sweden. And what it basically shows is that you see countries cluster in the top right and bottom left. What it means is that the more democratic you are, the more likely you are to have high levels of good long-term public policy, high intergenerational solidarity. And conversely, the more autocratic you are, bottom left-hand corner, the worse your public policy in terms of long-termism. There are outliers like China, like Singapore, you can see there, but by and large, democracy, representative democracy, brings long-term public performance, good long-term public policy performance, but every democracy could be performing more effectively. And that's why I believe we need to redesign institutions for the long-term. In the UK, for example, or in Wales, there's a Future Generations Commissioner whose job is to focus on impacts of public policy 30 years in the future. I'm supporting a campaign going through the UK Parliament at the moment for the whole UK to have a Future Generations Commissioner. In Japan, there's amazing grassroots policy making for long-termism. This is images from a project called Future Design. It's a methodology used in cities and towns for long-term public policy decision-making. They invite local citizens along randomly to make plans for their cities. They're divided into two groups. One group are told they're citizens from the present, and the second group are told they're citizens from the year 2060, given these almost ceremonial green kimonos to wear. And it turns out the citizens who imagine themselves from 2060 have much better or much more radical plans they come up with for their cities, for their towns, in terms of environment policy and education and healthcare. This is spreading across municipalities in Japan. I think it's a really inspiring example that could be adopted elsewhere. So let me just now wrap up by saying that I've offered now four different ways to think about, in a way, decolonizing the future. And let's recognize that we are in an extraordinary moment of history because of COVID-19. a moment of opportunity, a moment of potential change. The economist Milton Friedman, who I don't quote very often, once said, only a crisis, real or perceived, can create real change. And I think that's where we are now. We know that out of crises like the Second World War came extraordinary pioneering long-term institutions, the World Health Organization, the European Union, welfare states, the National Health Service in Britain, across the board. So here we are at this moment facing our own long-term risks from the climate crisis, from technology, intergenerational injustice and racism. What are we going to do? Are we going to step up to the plate? And I believe we do have the chance to become cathedral thinkers. We have an opportunity. We can do this. We can become the long-term good ancestors that our future generations deserve. And let me stop right there and hand back over to Pablo. And just let me just say again, this is the next part you're going to go into, is really exciting for me. You're going to be discovering this great work of fantastic cartoonist. So have a nice time and I'll see you a little later.
Thank you, Roman. Thank you so much. Hello, friends. My name is Pablo, Pablo Suarez. Like Jano, I'm affiliated to both the Boston University Pardee Center for the Study of the Longer Range Future and to the Red Cross Red Crescent Climate Center. Long-term and seemingly short-term, working together and super excited to have you all. We have in the list of participants from scholars to donors to an editor from The Economist to a theologian. I love this. So what are we going to do now? We just heard Roman share four of the main threads in his awesome just released book, The Good Ancestor. And he mentioned cartoon artists. Our artists today are Feggo, Kendra Allenby, and Rebeka Ryvola. They have been working in collaboration with Roman, myself, and a few others, and cartoon collections, to come up with visual depictions of things that can provoke interesting conversations. The goal is not to make you laugh. The goal is to help us converse about the longer range future. There's about 15 cartoons organized in the four themes. You will only experience the ones of the theme that you end up conversing about in your Zoom group. Just to give you a taste, we are going to invite you to go into a gallery, dive into them, contemplate, appreciate what is appreciable, and challenge what is challengeable about what's depicted there, whether you don't agree with the book or you don't agree with the cartoonist's take on the book. When you're done enjoying any individual cartoon, you can annotate if you want. You can write a question triggered by it, an insight that can nurture your group discussion. In a moment, you will be sent to small groups of five or less, and you will have basically invitation to reflect on the four themes, right? Which of the four? Intergenerational justice, cathedral thinking, etc. You will discuss the question that you chose. The cartoons are your thought-provoking support. Converse, have a good time. And then as a team, because you're a team, you'll have to write one shared collective response to that question. Keep it to 100 words or less so it can be read in time. Write a new question you want to ask Roman as a group. And if you have time, maybe you want to share one insight triggered by the cartoon. When you return to the plenary, you'll be invited to copy-paste your group's text into the chat so that Roman can read and respond to that.
to kick off, we have a great question from the group on redesigning democracy. It comes from Margaret Arnold. She says, I hope it's possible to redesign democracy to overcome short-term thinking. The cartoon that most resonated with her was the older woman giving her vote to the child. And she notes that some countries may be organizing citizen assemblies for climate decision-making, maybe emphasizing the intergenerational aspects of this, focusing on changes that elders have seen, hopes, priorities for younger people. So this would require scientists, philosophers, et cetera, being part of the conversation. Can you respond to this insight?
Yeah, I mean, that cartoon of the child being given the vote by the grandparent, I absolutely love that one as well. And I think it's partly derived from something that my partner and I did during the time of the last UK general election, which was at the end of last year. At that time, we decided to give our 11-year-old twins an unusual birthday present. We decided to give them our votes. So we sat around the kitchen table, discussed the different party manifestos and even how the electoral system worked. And then they told us where to put the X on the ballot sheet. And in case you're wondering, they didn't exactly copy their parents' political opinions. But we did it, of course, because it was about empowerment. It was about agency. And I think that one of the great tragedies of modern representative democracy is that sense that people don't feel agency or power, the idea of delegating power to representatives who don't really represent you very much. And that's partly, I think, what's empowered the extraordinary rise of citizen assembly movements in the last 5 to 10 years across the globe. This is like a revival of the ancient Greek ideal of participatory democracy, but expanding the who gets to do it from just men, you know, or just wealthy men and not women and not slaves and not immigrants, not metics, as the Greeks called them. And we're seeing these citizen assemblies all over the place in municipal decision-making in Belgium, in Spain, in Ireland. They've had their citizens assembly, which is very important in discussing abortion issues that led to the famous referendum there a couple of years ago. They also discuss climate issues too. And in the UK, there's the Climate Assembly UK, which was instigated by the government to discuss how the country is going to move towards a net zero carbon economy. So I think there's enormous potential there. The beauty of the citizen assembly is when it is incredibly inclusive. So it's based on sortition, randomly bringing people in, and they draw in experts to give them briefings. In my view, the problem with a lot of these assemblies is they haven't brought enough young people into them. I think we need to, at least in my view, it's actually from the age of 13 or above. It's probably a decent rule of thumb. You know, just think of all those hundreds of thousands of school students who've been on the streets protesting about climate change, including my kids. They're incredibly informed about climate issues and other long-term issues. So I think we need to be adventurous with the way we experiment with the new citizen assembly movement and use it to revitalize democracy from the ground up.
That's a great segue into the next question I'd like to share with you. This is thoughts from the discussion on intergenerational justice. And Julia Mars writes, we should be trying to maintain sustained interactions with our idea of future generations. Many nations act on environmental and economic issues without taking into account future generations. So how do we move to a society in which sharing is valued? If we look at historical paradigm shifts, those who initiated them may not have known that their influence would extend so far into the future. The tyranny of the now, our conception of time as linear rather than cyclical, as some scientists do, means that we continue to do the things that we don't want to see in the future.
That's a big question. That's almost my whole book in a way. But I love that because it's really about how do we, the way I think about it, and I think this speaks to the question a bit, is how do we expand our moral circle, our circle of values? Now, my previous books, a lot of them have focused on empathy. How do we step into the shoes of people who are on the margins, who are voiceless, powerless, and try and see the world through their eyes? But I've tended to focus on how do we expand our empathy in today's world to marginalized people in our own countries or in developing countries. And what this book is about is really how do we expand that moral circle forward in time? So not just space, but through time. And making that connection is very difficult. I think that it needs to be embedded in different aspects of society. I believe that it needs to be put into constitutional law to ring fence the rights of future generations so they can't just be snatched away by politicians driven by short-termism. I believe it needs to be put into the education system. We know that this is about the idea of an imagined community. Back in the 1980s, the historian Benedict Anderson talked about the creation of the imagined community of the nation state, thinking not just about family or town or city, but making sacrifices and caring about people you could never meet within the boundaries of your country. Well, we need to expand our imagined community forward in time, and that's what education and also religion can do. They can instigate those kind of values. I mean, even the Catholic Church is starting to do it. The Pope started talking about intergenerational solidarity, intergenerational justice. Whether they put that into practice or not is a different matter. You know, the Vatican Bank, who knows whether they've divested from fossil fuels? We don't actually know, really. I think they keep all these things secret. I imagine that they haven't. So I think it's a really great question. I think it needs a multifaceted approach to this is how paradigm change happens. But ultimately, I believe in the power of ideas being a good ancestor.
Great. I've got a question from Alain Etienne from Boston University. How do we balance trying to build for the future with the fact that we don't know what the future will need or want? The future is imaginary. We can only work with what we imagine the future will be. Is compost thinking a better term than cathedral thinking, providing nutrients for the future rather than establishing a specific place or system for them?
That's a brilliant question. I love compost thinking because I often think about sewer thinking when I'm thinking that example of the Victorian sewers. I think sewer thinking, we've got enough cathedrals, but maybe we need more compost. But it's a really great question. I think that this is a very dangerous terrain, I think, the idea that we know so little about the future. A lot of people take this view that we know so little about future, how could we possibly plan? Therefore, let's not plan. Let's wait for the future to hit us in the present. And in futures thinking, they have this idea of the cone of possibilities or the cone of uncertainties. The further out you go in terms of time, the more possibilities there are. How could you know? A famous futurist once said, knowledge of the future is a contradiction in terms. I don't believe that. I think we know an enormous amount about the future that is coming our way, particularly in terms of what living things, human beings, other species will need to survive over the long term. And the basic thing is this, we need to live within the biocapacity of the one planet we know that sustains life. Whether you're living in 2020 or 2220, there needs to be air you can breathe and food you can eat. This is the basics of sustenance. That's why I love the idea of planetary boundaries from the work of people like Will Steffen and Johan Rockström. You find it in donut economics. Let's live within the biocapacity of the planet. You know, I remember when I studied economics in the late 80s, early 90s, I never studied ecological economics. I'd never heard of Herman Daly. I'd never heard of the idea of, well, that the circular flow of income or demand and supply graph needs to have a big circle around it, which is called the planet, the environment. But that's where my thinking has finally led me to. And I think ultimately these are a kind of anchors in an uncertain world, which give us the certainty of what we know we need to act upon.
Our next question comes from Ahmed Azari, also from Boston University. And he's saying that we need a system to balance threats, starting with man-made threats, since nature threats have been existing forever. The question is that natural disasters have always existed, we're able to handle them, but man-made ones, we don't have experience in handling. So there's this importance of intersectionality, seeing the whole system, focusing on interactions rather than elements, which simplifies the future thinking. The idea of cumulative anthropogenic threats have become singular common roots. Thinking about inequity, mass extinction, climate change, overpopulation, really all in a single common problem of humanity, thinking of itself as apart from nature, prioritizing the immediate future. If you break this and fix everything, so should we focus on one problem as a collective or multiple problems as individuals? And how should we philosophically categorize which global issues we should focus on?
Okay, that's a really wonderful and complex question. I mean, there's in the last 10 years, roughly, there's been the rise of the idea of existential risk. This is the idea that there are some risks which might literally destroy human existence completely or near completely, so greatly that our civilizations are permanently diminished. So people often talk about, well, maybe there'll be a genetically engineered pandemic that will wipe out humankind, or nuclear winters and this kind of thing, asteroids hitting us. It's a certain category of risk. So some people, the way they deal with those different kinds of risks is to try and put probabilities towards them. So there's a very interesting book recently by the British moral philosopher Toby Ord called The Precipice on existential risk. And he says, well, there's about in his view, about a 1 in a million chance we'll be wiped out by asteroids, about 1 in 1,000 chance that climate change will permanently wipe out human civilization or something close to it, but about a 1 in 10 chance that AI will do the damage. And in fact, he says there's a 1 in 6 chance that humankind will probably not make it to the end of this century without some kind of great global catastrophe. Now, that's a very extreme way of looking at it. I don't tend to take that view, because in that view, you're not really necessarily caring about maybe hundreds of millions of people being hit by climate risks today or in 10 years or in 50 years, which may not wipe out the human species, but is certainly, I think, of great moral importance. So we need to try and look at these sort of different levels of risk and different kinds of risk. But at its base, I think, in a way, going back to what I said before, I love the work of Janine Benyus, the biomimicry expert, who says, how have animal species learned to survive over the long term for 3.8 billion years of Earth's life? Well, they've done it by not fouling the nest. That's how you survive for generation upon generation, even though you don't know what the world is going to be like. And yet we foul the nest unbelievably. We use an average of 1.6 planet Earths per year. So I think that, in a way, is the common denominator of all these kinds of risks that we're talking about. Let's learn to live within those boundaries.
I'm going to zero in a little bit on this question, thinking about, it was a two-part question, but I'm going to jump to the second one. So the first one was on how to balance responsibilities of future generations and obligations to current generations. But then zooming in, what is the responsibility of developed nations to developing nations, given that developing countries have not benefited in the past from globalization or been actively exploited by developing countries in order to secure against long-term risks, technology, justice, climate? So if you were in power as a UN member or world leader, what would you do to address intergenerational justice?
By a weird coincidence, my wife at this very moment is on a conference with the deputy head of the UN. And so she should be really down here answering that question. She's an ecological economist. But since she's not here, I'll try and answer that. Certainly, I think anyone who takes long-term thinking seriously will look into the past as well into the future. And we know that it has been the developed nations, Western global North nations, that have gone way over their fair share of ecological damage, which they've wrought on the world since the Industrial Revolution. And there's a very strong argument, of course, that they should be the ones who should be prioritizing and taking the major burden of reining in their emissions of global greenhouse gases and material use. I think that's only fair. On the other hand, we need to recognize that if we are going to survive as a species into the long term, that even in low-income countries, there need to be new experiments with new forms of industrial development or new forms of development, which don't just go back to the old industrial models. So I'm very inspired by examples like in Bangladesh, for example, where there's been what's sometimes been called a swarm electrification program, where over 4 million people, particularly in rural areas, now have solar panels on their roofs. And by 2030, there's going to be up to 10,000 peer-to-peer solar networks. And this is how you really, I think, ideally, you jump the old industrial model to something that is both redistributive and regenerative at the same time. In other words, you're bringing people above the basic social foundations, what they need to survive, because they're no longer beholden to big electricity companies. They're buying and selling electricity they make themselves. And yet they're not pushing their country or the globe outside the boundaries of what the planet can sustain. So we need to be looking for those kinds of models, I think, if we're going to have really deep, you know, green development over the long term.
Yeah, and we need to support the leapfrogging transformational potential there. I have a great question, bringing it kind of home to the personal level. This comes from Roop Singh from our Climate Center team. What are the tiny daily habits that I can do every day to take into account long-term thinking?
Yeah, that's a great question. How do we actually bring this into personal life? Because it's easy for it to be at a distance, isn't it? I mean, if you look at lots of the fantastic cartoons that have been created, a lot of them are quite personal. You know, whether it is the one about handing on your vote to somebody, or you're standing in front of a giant tree, thinking about the legacy that you may leave and how you may be judged by future generations. These things touch us personally, but what can we do? I think one thing, I can tell you what I do. Let's for a start. I love trying to get in touch with the idea of deep time, the idea that humankind is just a small moment in the great expanse of cosmic history. So a couple of days ago, I went with my kids to visit a tree which is over 1,000 years old. You can go to, you know, the White Mountains in California and find bristlecone pines which are 5,000 years old. You can look at a star and realize that that light maybe left that star before humankind even emerged, or hold a fossil in your hand that's 200 million years old. These are all ways, I think, of touching a different temporal sphere. And I think when we do that, we recognize, well, we come to a question, which is, who are we to break the great chain of life and existence? You know, within just the last couple of hundred years, we've wrought untold damage with our ecological degradation and technological madness. So who are we to break that? But I think there's other ways we can do it in everyday life. I mean, obviously there's things like you put your solar panels on your roof, you know, or you think to yourself, okay, when I am shopping, when I'm going on vacation, am I being a good ancestor? Who is this going to affect? Can I actually try to bring seventh generation thinking into my church, into my community group? What would it mean to be a good ancestor in my, you know, local community center? Would we have a 100-year plan? Would we become a B Corp and have environmental policy written into our articles of association as much as anything else? So I think there's all sorts of everyday things, but we need collective action as well as individual.
Unfortunately, because of time, we're not going to be able to share with you all of the questions that have come in. But before we go into the closing, I'd like to give you the opportunity, if there's something that maybe you've noticed scrolling through the questions in the chat, Roman, that you would really like to address as a last insight with us.
I just see the word metaphor there, actually. And I think a lot of this is about the ideas, about recognizing that if you're going to change society, you need to change the paradigm. You know, I've probably got Donella Meadows' book, Thinking in Systems, right next to me here somewhere, if I could find it. And it's a recognition, I think, books like that, or works of Thomas Kuhn or Pierre Bourdieu or wherever, Karl Mannheim, that if we're going to change our societies, we need to change the way we think. You know, I've got a copy of the Marxist Reader up here my grandfather gave me when I was 16. He believed you need to change the economic structures before anything else changes. I have some belief in that, but I also recognize that we need the new metaphors. We need to talk about being good ancestors. We need to talk about joining a time rebellion. There are incredible organizations, many of them mentioned in the chat there, embarked on long-term thinking and in intergenerational justice. There is something extraordinary going on here. We need to recognize that we can build on this. And I love the way that the cartoons spark new conversations, new thinking. I used to work with a historian called Theodore Zeldin, who said that a satisfying conversation is one which makes you say what you have never said before. And certainly when I look at the cartoons, they've helped me say things and think things I've never said or thought before about long-term thinking. So take them with you today. Take some of the ideas I've talked about. Have a look at my book if you can, and see if you can begin that journey towards being a good ancestor.
So first of all, thank you all for your very active contribution. Thank you, Roman. This has been fantastic. And there are three cartoons that I'm going to share that will be made available to participants in this event. There you see one by Kendra. You can see this one by Rebeka, which was mentioned earlier. And there is this one by Feggo, which was also mentioned. So they will also be available at cartooncollections.com. Those of us who are part of this event and Roman can make use of this art. If you want to use it for something else outside of the context of this event, the proper way is to license it. The artists also need to make a living since they are capable of inviting us to think, to reflect, to enrich. Roman, a public philosopher who agreed to join a humanitarian team and an academic team triggered by artists making cartoons for it. Thank you very, very much. Friends from the Pardee Center for the Study of a Longer Range Future at BU, thank you so much for hosting this. Thank you, Daniel and Brady from Good Focus, for creating the gallery that allowed participants to dive into the cartoons, experience, share comments, and see what other people wrote. We're making more out of it. Our team, the Red Cross, Red Crescent Climate Center, with support from EIT Climate-KIC, has been the champion of this very unusual collision of styles and perspectives and more. And we're especially grateful to all of you who showed up. Thank you for being with us. Thank you all, and there shall be more.